new purpose or to the new job, and you're going to have to march to their drum, right? So as an entrepreneur myself, I did it for me. And so literally, at the end of this month, everything here is changing. Mm-hmm. And what we're going to do as a business in April, May, June, which is Q2, is going to be completely different than what we did this quarter. What we did this quarter was completely different than what we did in Q4, when we basically shut everything down to figure out what we're going to do next. Yada, 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 yada. You got a question?
Yeah.
All right. Are you sure?
Oh, yeah. I think what you mean about love is actually a balance between what you're happy, like maybe helping the community and also balancing your school and also being an entrepreneur at the same time. It's like a catalyst of yourself in your mind and heart, I think. That's what I do. Like, I want to help the Syrian refugees.
Sure.
Just balancing my architectural school and my job. And it's like something that I am really profoundly affected by.
It's beautiful to be able to create the opportunities in your life and manifest your own experience, right? Manifest your own reality. When you first want to do whatever it is that you want to do, when I wanted to start this company, nobody would join up. I'm like, yo, we're going to start this company. It's going to be crazy. I need some help. Come on. Have you seen that movie, Show Me Money? Tom Cruise?
Yeah,
what's that movie called?
Mission Impossible?
No.
The Last Samurai?
Jerry Maguire.
Oh, Jerry Maguire.
Everybody seen Jerry Maguire?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah,
I've not seen Jerry Maguire. You gotta watch references. You want to bring people on board, right? Mm-hmm. But people don't see what you're going to build. Then when you build this reality, others will join you in it, right? Either join your team, mm-hmm. right? Or join you as clients, or join you as partners, community partners, etc. And so what you're talking about is being able to manifest your own reality to be able to support the goals and aspirations that you have. For example, we had a class of the Syrian refugees that are here. Some of them, not all of them, are the Syrian refugees. So some of the people that are here that have immigrated to Canada, they're living in a hotel temporarily set up on Spadina and Dundas. They needed a place to do English tutoring classes. We opened up a space, opened up our classroom for them, and they had classes here. It was awesome.
Can we talk later?
Right, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Right here. Yeah, it was beautiful, right? And I'm like, I saw them all come in, and I'm like, oh shoot, what would my mom want me to do, right? So I put together like plates of tea and everything, and I came around and I gave them all tea, and it was beautiful. It was a new convention. I was only able to do that because I manifested this reality to be able to do things. Any other questions before we go out?
Yeah, so you're saying that every quarter you're changing what you're doing,
and
or like just to get there.
Yeah.
How does that process happen? Like, who is
the process? That is the exercise that we're going to go through together in 15 minutes. Okay. So, Big Sean says dreams stop being dreams when you turn them into goals, right? And so we're gonna look at how we can translate our dreams into tangible goals and outcomes that we can actually achieve. Also, be a simple process to how to do that. And you can carry that away with you and ask me questions about it afterwards. It is the foundation of how I was able to build this business. Real talk. We need to move on.
Yeah, it's next.
Next. So, all right, so we won't cover online. That's very weird. Yes.
So how did this come from ducks? You mentioned you do very modern ducks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was that anywhere here? Was the 0-100? All right.
Yeah.
Cool. What happened? We started at so I was at an agency, no shade on them, they're cool and everything, but I'm like, I want more meaning in my life than to work at an agency. My culture is different. I want to be able to relate to people. I want the work that I do to be more impactful. And I would like to control the framework through which that happens. And so I hustled like that, right? I built up a year's worth of salary in the course of about 2 months. It's pretty remarkable stuff. Amazing. And I talked to my wife about it, and she's like, screw it, go for it, right? And I quit my job, and I wasn't even at CSI. There's a place that used to be open called Zoe's Bakery on King Street.
Yeah.
And I just camped out there. I did a table, and I'd order like throughout the day, and that was my office for about three weeks. And they were cool and everything because I ordered crazy amounts of food. business, no clients. I don't know how to, well, I know how to get clients because I did it for a minute, right? But how am I, what am I actually going to do? What are the goals that I'm actually going to set for myself? Hop, skip, jump. I'm like, I care about social impact. Applied to the Center for Social Innovation. They accepted our application. It's not that tough, but it seemed like a big deal at the time. I'm like, oh my god, I got to submit an application. I hope they let me in. The Center for Social Innovation won't give me a desk. And somebody was probably standing there being like, check, 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 up, give them a desk, right? And what seemed like a big giant leap was actually, you know, there's practical, tangible steps to go through step by step to be able to get there. I got a desk, and I wanted to start building this essay writing app that we have, right? So it's called the Writing Project. I want to build an essay writing app. Me and my wife, she's a professor, she's been teaching it. We found a framework for teaching essay writing. Like, how am I going to build this app? I don't have any developers or nothing. I'm like, okay, I got to get some consulting going. So I found a client. One of the clients that I hustled with for those 2 months just carried over. And then I needed to hire someone to do some work for it because I was outside of my technical depth. And for every like 2 hours they worked on client work, they spent an equal 2 hours. I paid them from the profits to work on the writing project. And next thing you know, I had another client. I'm like, I need somebody else to help me with this. And I got a second hot desk. So now I have the same person, two people rotating the weekly hot desk. And it's a snowball effect. And while I was there at the Center for Social Innovation, I see this guy walking past. His name is Blake. Shout out to Blake if you watch this. Much love. He's walking through with his dog. And I'm like, Blake, what are you doing here? He was one of the clients who I designed a website for during my hustle period, right? I'm like, what are you doing here? He's like, I have an office, right? He builds a social impact energy product, right? And he's like, what are you up to? So I explained to him, he's like, well, let's talk after. Turns out Blake had a project for me, right? Blake was our first major client, crazy. Like, this was like the first actual month of operation, January. And wow, right? So then I needed to bring on one full-time designer, one full-time developer, as well as myself. And we spent a little bit of time on the writing project, but a lot of time on Blake's project. And I think we screwed that project up. I'm sorry, Blake. I'm sorry. The design was amazing, but I don't think the development of it was really, really good, right? But we helped him iterate. At least we gave him a product that helped him grow his business out a little bit, right? And then the snowball just continued. We just started getting more clients, and two desks turned into three, three turned into four, four turned into like six people squatting at four desks, and CSI being like, you can't do that. And I'm like, but if we keep getting more desks, we're going to take over like half of the floor, right? So we got this tiny little office that was like this small, and we fit six people in it by using... So these tables aren't because they're cool and you could like write on them and everything. But we got them because they were really narrow, so we could stick them up against the walls, and so we could fit a whole bunch of desks in that little tiny office, right? And then we worked out of there for a bit, and by the 24, why the growth happened. The growth happened not because we wanted to be good UX UI designers, or because we wanted to, you know, help people build apps. Really don't care about designing anything for anyone. If we could get away with not designing anything at all, and helping our clients get mountains of money so that they could turn that around and provide impact in society and return on investment, that would be amazing. So our core focus was helping people achieve their business goals. What are your business goals? So somebody comes and says, I want you to design this app for me. Okay, so what are you going to do with it after we're done designing it? How much money are you actually going to spend on it? So we're going to finish designing it, and then what? So I just left my job, have two kids, and I'm right, all about passion, and I want to have social impact, and da-da-da, and I'm spending time away from my kids to do something meaningful, but I'm getting wasted like 3 or 4 or 5 months of my time on an app for you, and you don't have a plan, or you're not going to be able to prove to me that you could actually bring something successful out of it. So we challenge every single person we work with. And because of that business-focused approach to everything that we do, we started attracting people that were serious business, right? And So there's a, I have this publication called The Business of This Business is My Business. Right? I'm not here for design or development or relationship building and all that. I'm here to help people achieve business growth and to figure out how to set up a framework to make that happen. And geez, that resonated. Because not only that, but we were wicked sick at UX design and UI design, and we got better at development too, right? So we had the actual production muscle to be able to execute on the things, right? So now this turned into, we do workshops with people to figure out if they're doing the right thing before we even talk about doing anything. And that was paid. They pay us to do that, right? It's not, we don't give that away for free. It's not like a consultation where we have coffee and you tell me everything and then I learn and then I give you a proposal and da-da-da. We don't set up proposals and pitch it to you. We open up a Google Drive document and say, let's create a project together. You invest in it and you write down the things that you want and I'll challenge you on that. And then we'll kick off workshops. We kick off the workshops. After that 1 week or 2 weeks of workshops, if it's legit, go, right? And that just led us to exponential growth. We hit crazy numbers in the first year. So 2014 was weak. 2014 was like 200 and something thousand dollars, right, in 1 year. Which is, it's actually all right, right? Half of that time was, half of that money was dedicated to employees, a little bit of my salary, and I think we had like $60,000 in profit at the end of that year. 2015 was like a $2-something million year. That's nuts. That's crazy. From a kid that grew up in the projects, I had nothing. I dropped out of college and university. I was like, I was hustling when I was a teenager, right? I'm lucky I got into university. Even when I was there, like I said, right? This is a reality that was unimaginable for me, but that I was able to manifest because I manifested, because I created the frameworks and the environment for myself, and I took the risk and gave the opportunity to be able to draw like-minded forces, right? That's it. We moved to an office on Camden Street, 2,000 square feet. It was all right. It was really cool. We had like a little boardroom that doubled as the first classroom for the courses that we gave. But it was too small. You know, you have a client meeting, and then the studio's right there, and everybody hears what's up, and it's too disruptive, and we got people playing NHL like right down there, and then there's the kitchen. It wasn't big enough, right? We wanted to have a bigger classroom. We wanted to host all our own community events instead of hosting them in other places. It was a meetup called Toronto UX. It was crazy, popping off in 2014 and in early 2015. And so we did the transition to come into here, right? And in July of 2015, we got into this office. And that doesn't mean success. That doesn't mean like it's not like you go to 0-100 and it's done. Right? Just 0-100 real quick, and it's like, wait, I gotta go this way. And you gotta go 0-100 real quick that way. And then you figure out, oh wait, I need to go into another direction. Because if I knew exactly where we need to end up in like 5 years, or in 4 years, or in 2 years, or if I look past 6 months, I may very well be limiting myself to what we can actually achieve. Because 6 months from now, the 6 month older me is gonna be like, fill your plans for a week. What are you talking about? Look at where you are and all the opportunities that are afforded to you now. Switch it up, right? That's how the 0-100 happens. Any questions on that?
Can you break down what happens after the consultation and workshop? What's actually the
production, right? It goes straight into production. So what does that mean? That means anything from everything that you do in products building, right? You do user experience design, so you do information architecture, interaction design, UI design, visual design, packaging it up, helping make sure that they're going to present it well. And I could share with you, I'm happy to share with everyone here what our actual process is to doing that. We also hold workshops if you ever want to take one of our classes. We go deep into all of this. So in order to be able to scale this is really important. Every time you get a new client, you're going to be like, okay, now how are we going to do this? And you're going to need to figure out how you're going to do the project. And then you get a new client, and you're going to ask, how are we going to do this project? So what we did is we started setting up templates from day one. Oh, it's a project that needs some information architecture, some interaction design, and a workshop. Here's exactly how our workshop runs. Here's exactly how our interaction design processes. Here's exactly what our information architecture process is. We go through that process with the client. We iterate that template, and we use it for the next one. Then when you want to share it with people, it will scale, because you don't really have to teach them too much, right? Just help facilitate how they go through that process. questions? We'll talk about the money part after, because I know you want to be all that. So 0 to 100, real quick. What's next? Go ahead.
What you did during your like software time to question why are you building the product? Like when you are doing
yes,
the
I mean, you're doing it in class right now, imagine if you have to write an essay on something, or if you have to present a research project, you have to figure out why you're doing it, what the impact of it is gonna be before you go ahead and do it, right? You can't just make a painting right away. You're like, you made it great. It's not gonna work, right? I have like back in that time, the time I got my first 80 on an essay, my teacher was like, listen, come every single morning, show me what you're working on, I'll give you some feedback, and then come the next morning, right? So I'd like to write a couple pieces of my introduction, and I'd be there at 8 o'clock. So like, okay, this is good, that's bad, change this, change that. Not only did she give me feedback, but she gave me buy-in and a green light to move forward. The next day, again, a little bit more of the introduction, I finished it, she gives me feedback, change this, this, and that. If I change it, and if I implement her feedback, and if she's giving me a green light to move forward, how is she going to give me a bad mark or not be happy? By the end of the process, we basically co-created and co-built the essay together with her direction. We got an 88. I'm scratching my head, I'm like, where did the rest of like 12% go, right? that goes wherever that goes, but at least we have a higher measure of success.
Yeah.
Future of this industry. So a lot of these companies have been closing up shop, yeah? Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
Do you know who they are?
So many consulting firms are actually buying like Accenture, FJORD.
Rock, yeah.
Yeah, then this guy, McKinsey bought a consulting firm. Yeah. Capital One bought a consulting firm. So,
but I forgot what their name is. And whoever just sold to, IDEO just sold a chunk of their piece to somebody else, right? What about local? Does anybody know local design companies that have shut down recently?
Why?
Oh, Diner?
Okay. Daniel.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
Y-R.
Sorry?
Y-R.
T-Hen-Lax shut down. You all know T-Hen-Lax? They are coming back to our
day. Kmart?
They didn't get bought out. They went to
San Francisco.
Kmart.
They went to San Francisco. So they didn't get bought out. They basically shut down and took jobs. Right?
Dublin?
Okay. Sorry, IDEO? No, IDEO. So here's what happened, and you should read about this. IDEO joined a consortium of a whole bunch of agencies that are like a mafia of agencies.
Yeah.
They still do, but they're just bought out.
Yeah, they just sold a big chunk of their company. Yeah. So a lot of little design companies have been shutting down. So why have they been shutting down, right?
Because losing revenue.
Losing revenue, why?
Because they're not able to sell, and their products weren't.
Why can't they sell?
They don't know how to advertise.
No, not that.
They have different needs.
How are they fulfilling those needs? How do you think? Well, agencies are expensive. Like we build, you know, we're need to build in order to be able to sustain the practices and the environment to be able to move real quick for the next company that wants to hire us. So these big companies, like, let's just build our agencies in-house. Right? So let's buy agencies, bring them in-house, or let's just bring up our own agencies. So when we saw this happening, so I saw this started to happen, like, once I started this company, you can't just build a UX agency that is cares about human-centric design and that's not gonna, how are we gonna diversify? So we do business consulting, right? The workshop stuff. And we'll do design. Let's do some education as well, right? So let's be able to teach people, right? Let's do education for organizations as well as for individuals. And let's have some community involvement. Now, when you bring all of those together, it brings different things into your world, right? It's not just the traditional, I need to hire an agency. Because people still ask us, like, what do you do? So I went to your website. What do you do? That's not a good thing. That's bad. I got to work on that. I got a lot of work to do, but I did, right? But what's really happened isn't that we started these agencies so they never hire agencies again. the main problem between the big, like the big giant companies and the little company, like the agency, is that this is like, what's a big giant company? Like a big, like say TE Bank would go to an agency.
Towers?
Sure, right? So they go to an agency and they say, we need some work. And they just be like, yeah, we can do work, yeah, we can help you out with that. And they control the process. They're like magicians, you know? You need design and user experience? We can do that, yeah. We'll do that for you. It's like, there you go, right?
Yeah.
So that was very, very valuable. No matter how many partnership, process, technique, collaboration, transparency, they still own the process, and they did not have the expertise. So these guys are like, yeah, we're just going to bring this in.